Society on BCTV is supported in part by the Highlands at Wyomissing.
Hello and welcome to the monthly program of the Historical Society of Berks County. I'm your host, George M. Meiser IX, President Emeritus of the Historical Society of Berks County. It should be noted that this program is telecast live on the first Wednesday of each month at 7. It repeats this Friday at 10, Saturday at 6, and Sunday morning at 9 a.m. Welcome all to our April 2011 program. Seated to my right is Kimberly Richards, who is the archivist at the Historical Society. And beside her is Joshua Blay, curator and associate director of the Historical Society.
Hello, George.
And seated to his side is Simon Bertlett, Executive Director of the Historical Society of Berks County.
George.
Good evening.
Our museum, Henry Anson Library, museum store are open Tuesday through Saturday from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. Program note, at least I don't have to say anything about snow and inclement weather, but we will be closed Good Friday and also Easter Saturday at the end of April. Our museum store has a large inventory of books and also items by local artisans and potterers, and we have some new books in on racing to go ahead with our exhibit, which you're hearing about a little bit, and we've also been posting some new books to our online store as well.
How do they get to the online, to that online store?
Just go to our main website, berkshistory.org, www.berkshistory.org.
And yeah, the org is important.
Yes, and you'll see a button there for museum store there. Yeah, and all the books right there, and we have some magazines up there. There's a thumbnail image of each one and a description of each, along with the cost, including postpaid as well.
Oh, that's very good. We remind viewers that for $40 a year, you can be one of us, a member of the Historical Society of Berks County. Membership in the society includes our prize-winning quarterly magazine, The Historical Review of Berks County. Membership includes unlimited use of the museum and library. Incidentally, family memberships, all living in the same house, are $50 a year.
And while we're on the subject of membership, George, we remind you that Berks Community TV, BCTV, is a survivor in a tough venue and that it's interactive. You're encouraged to call in with your questions and comments to 610-378-0426.
So why not salute BCTV for all the great shows it provides to Reading and Berks? Send a check for $30 for a year's membership. Mail your check to BCTV, 645 Penn Street, Reading, Pennsylvania, 19601. Remember, time passes, but operating expenses never go away. Let's begin today's program with a few views now being processed for inclusion in the Society's upcoming publication, The Passing Scene, Volume 19, due out this coming November. I believe, okay. This just came today, folks. It was dated on the back 1920, and that is about right. We're looking here on the lower right-hand side to the Bingham Street Bridge. Some of us who are interested in local history will know that we used to have a covered bridge. Well, we had what they called the three Reading covered bridges, the one at Poplar Neck, and this one, and the one at Penn Street, or the Harrisburg Bridge. Well, this was called the Lancaster Bridge. It burned, the wooden one burned in 1872, and it was replaced with the Iron Truss Bridge that you see in the screen in the lower right-hand side. That became structurally compromised prior to the one at Penn Street. And around 1920, a little before that, they began working on replacing it with the structure, the cement bridge that we have today, leading over to Lancaster Avenue. Now, if is there such a thing as zooming in a bit? Can that be done? I'm looking at the building in dead center. There are two things in this picture. What you're looking at here...
I can use a pointer here.
Oh, can you do that?
Yeah, there's one right here. Whoop. There we go.
Okay, very good. Now, dead center. Dead center, you see what had been the Repis Ironworks building. When you walk through the city of Reading, every fire escape you see, every those gratings at the little windows in the front of each house where they used to use to put coal in the cellar, those metal cellar doors that you see flush with the sidewalk up Penn Street and places of that sort, those were all made at the Repis Ironworks, including the old ornate iron fountains that used to be in City Park. Anyhow, it was there. If you look at that very closely, and I guess we can zoom in, that was the Reading Standard Bicycle Works. Uh-huh. Now, the whole thing wasn't the Bicycle Works, it was Rempus Iron, but...
How do you spell Rempus?
R-E-M-P-P.
Rempus.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
The Rempus Iron Works. And it was there that the Reading Standard Motorcycle and the Reading Standard Bicycle was made. That building fronted on the Schuylkill Canal, and it was actually on, was that Canal Street? The building is long gone, actually, but there was something right below it. Can you get a pointer on that elongated...
That little cart right here?
To the right.
Oh, right here.
Yeah. That appears in a couple of old photographs with canal boats close by being caulked, and I never saw a close-up picture of that until this postcard came today. That was a revelation to me to find that picture. I had never seen that before. And to the right of that, sort of near that tree, is the famous Pack-A-Rack Hotel that some of the old-timers in Reading might remember. The Pack-A-Rack was relatively well-known to the local gentry.
Good times.
Yes, yes, good times is right. That is a really very, very interesting photograph that shows some things that that I've never seen in some other pictures. I cut a little off on the left-hand side, but there's material on the left-hand side, too, that's very, very, very interesting. And luckily, this is a fairly detailed picture, which I'm going to run in the next book in large size.
He must be sitting on top of a pole there.
Yes, I'm looking at that, too. That must have... Well, you know what? They had two very large structures there that they strung wire on as a suspension. By the way, I don't know whether you can see it, in the dead center lower part is the temporary bridge. Uh-huh. See, part of that was taken away, and they had a walkover bridge, the temporary bridge. Every time they would build a new bridge in Reading, they put up a temporary one. The Schuylkill Avenue Bridge had a temporary thing going across the Schuylkill over to Glenside.
Is that in the general neighborhood where that trolley bridge would have been?
That was down a bit more.
Down a
bit more. But anyhow, that's a great picture when you see that in detail, and that is a good detailed picture. You're going to see things there that you never saw before. Oh, and you can see how much bigger the present structure is, because today when you cross the Bingham Street Bridge, the tracks of the railroad runs beneath. Do you see to the in the center on the right? Yeah, when it was a grade level crossing. And they had railroad gates there. And right near there also was the old paper mill, one of the Reading paper mills, one of three.
Well, George, you said there were three Reading bridges. You had Poplar Neck.
Uh-huh.
You had the one that goes over, Lancaster. That would have been now is Binghamton, right?
Right.
And then you had Penn Street.
Which was the Harrisburg Bridge.
Now, what did they consider wasn't...
they were owned by Reading.
Oh, they were owned by Reading. I was going to say the one that goes over the Schuylkill Avenue Bridge. Refresh my memory.
That was Kissinger's originally, but that was privately owned.
Ah, okay.
That was one of those privately owned ones. Yeah, they always spoke about the three Reading bridges, and they all had, back in that picture, there's a toll house there. You paid toll on those things.
Is this little structure with the
That's it.
Right to the bridge.
Yeah, that was the toll house. Now, by the time that you got around to the metal bridge, they were no longer... Wait a minute. Yeah, they did collect toll, some of those bridges, well into the 80s. But the three Reading bridges, you would never think of the Poplar Neck as being a Reading bridge today, but it was. And the revenue from toll went into the city coffers. The next one, Joshua. This was a postcard that I purchased on eBay from a gentleman whom I will be seeing again very shortly because he has a keen interest in local history. Levi Moyer, packer of paper goods, something like, what was it, 707 was it?
To 713.
To 713. Now, I didn't know where these buildings were because this was a section that ordinarily you would not go to unless you had a good reason to go there. The main building was this structure on the left-hand side, and notice that he used actually two little frame homes that were quite old, even when this postcard was issued 100 years ago. And then there was a building over on the right-hand side that was all part of Levi Moyer's paper packing works. Well, I was curious about this picture. I couldn't, when I saw the postcard, I thought, well, I'm going to have to get that, and I did. And because I never saw those buildings before. So did they still exist? Next picture, Joshua. So I went to the 1913 city atlas. And now, running across left to right on the bottom of the screen is Walnut Street. And you're looking at the 700 block of Walnut Street. Now, that large building, which has had numerous fires over the year, right there at 7th. It's right up next to the railroad tracks at 7th. The Yoakum Brothers Cigar Factory. Now, that was owned, let's see, most recently, I think they sold furniture there, I think. Anyhow, that's a sizable building. Notice that it was on Zeber's Court. Now, Zeber's Court was usually a small street that had houses, and many times it was a dead-end situation. Now, what happened was, if you check the 1884 city atlas, you see a whole string of small frame homes running along the left side of Zeber's Court. That whole row was torn down to make way for the large cigar factory. Now, a friend of mine, Sonny Stewart, Horace Stewart, a musician known by some people and a piano tuner, his dad had owned that factory at one time, and his dad had made cigars, Stewart's cigars. And he tells me that if you go down into the basement of that building, there was actually like a tunnel underneath Walnut Street. And I oftentimes wonder, is that tunnel still there? I asked Bill Rare, the retired fire chief, whether he ever heard of a tunnel going under Walnut Street, and he said they were there for fires, but he never got downstairs to see whether that tunnel was still there. I thought that was interesting. Anyhow, Joshua, can you point to the O in Molino, the first
sure.
O?
Right here.
Okay, now point to the M. Right above the M is that brick building that we just saw on the postcard. And then to the right, we see those two small frame homes. And then next to that is a two-story affair that was just a little bit larger. Now, that was that complex that you see on the postcard. Now, what you don't see in the postcard is the next structure, which years ago was a blacksmith shop. And if you were to go turn right onto Molino Street itself, you see how small Molino Street is. That would actually take you back to the Luden the former Luden candy factory, right off Poplar Street. So anyhow, so what is there today? The next picture, please. That brick building that you saw on the left-hand side of the last picture, that is what you see there on the far left. Mm-hmm. And the two frame buildings are long since gone, and they would be about where Fire Chief Rare is standing. And then up to this, you can see that mark with the bricks change. That would have been the other building. And at some point or another, they joined all those buildings and, they enlarged the buildings and they put like a brick veneer across the whole works to make it look like one complex. And so that's what's there today. What's in it now? Nothing.
The street and the alley right in front of Chief Rare.
That's Molino.
Does that sit directly in back of what is now, there's a Fulton Bank there today? Fulton Bank fronts on Penn Street.
No, we're actually north of Walnut here. We're north of Walnut.
Okay.
So that, if you would, you see that white line, which is, if you would turn that corner, that would be part of Zeber's Court. Which, no houses there, that would be Zeber's Court. And today, that L arrangement that's formed by Zeber's Court Street and Molino Street, That's all that really exists there on Molino Street anymore, and I believe the property is up for sale. Fire Chief Rear tells me that he went to a fire back there, and there was an outfit with sewing machines making something, and the place caught on fire. So he was well aware of this property. But anyhow, isn't that neat how things have changed over the course of time? Can you go back one place?
If you're interested, give Century 21 a call. I can see their real estate sign there. There you go.
And one more. And that's what you're seeing. Chief Rare asked me, what is that strange, look at the very top where it says Levi. What is that extension out the sign? And the answer is, I have no idea, but it's not there today.
Just false work, maybe?
Yeah. But why that one side and not on the other? Unless it would have been infringed on the property line, which is possible. But anyhow, that's what happens over the course of time. The next picture, please. We're on Green Street, below 13th, on Green Street. This postcard popped up, and I must confess, I couldn't place the location. But there we have a gentleman standing on the right looking at these two frame structures, semi-detached. Now what you can see is that between these two buildings that are on the left, there's an alleyway before the brick house that you see almost directly before us. Police Chief Rare said, Fire Chief Rare said he knows exactly where they are. Those buildings are still there. I said, well, I really can't picture it. He said, well, let's go find them. So notice the gentleman standing on the right with the telephone pole behind him and those homes on the left, the next picture. Mm-hmm. Police, Fire Chief Rare stands at the exact same spot. And we have those two buildings that sit back. There's an alleyway and that brick building. Very good, Joshua.
Yep.
That's okay. Green Street below 13th. On the east side of Green Street. Hmm. Interesting. What happens in the course of one century? Okay, let's put that on ice and switch over to Mr. Blay.
Okay. I was just thinking to myself as the show got started, maybe I should start thinking about secondary employment as a race car mover. We're getting ready for a racing exhibit, which opens this Saturday, April 9th. Simon, you want to give them some details while I queue up some photos here?
Sure. Well, this is our major exhibit for 2011-2012, and it's entitled Racing in Reading and Berks. And it's brought to you by not only the Historical Society of Berks County, but also by the generosity of Penske Truck Leasing here in Reading, Pennsylvania. And it really is a great exhibit. Joshua and Kim Longlot and Kim Richards have done a wonderful job of putting together both three-dimensional and paper artifacts to bring this exhibit to you. It goes over the history and the legacy of racing in Reading and Berks, not only a chronological history, but also the many firsts that took place here in Reading and Berks County on the racing scene that have translated into what you see today, even at a NASCAR event. You know, and Josh, we went through so many things with this exhibit. The firsts from the promoters, like and the track preparation mm-hmm. that Lindy Vicari took care of out at the Reading
two-way radio communications,
right.
Timing on the track.
Yeah, the three-minute clock.
Three-minute clock getting out on the track itself.
Right.
I was going to say, while we're talking, maybe if they want to have a look at the posters on the floor, or we could do the...
Well, that's fine.
Yeah, look at the posters on the floor while we're talking here. It's everything. It's Maple Grove, it's Duryea Hill Climbs, the Fleetwood Hill Climb. There was a Rifton Hill Climb, motorcycle races. Billy Huber, he was a very well-known local gentleman of... cyclist. Unfortunately, he was killed out in Kansas in 1953, but they would hold a memorial race to him from the 1950s.
Yeah.
There's a sprint car poster from 62, I want to say. We have a sprint car in the room. Tommy Hinterschitz, a local racer from the Ole, the flying farmer. We have a sprint car in the room. We also have a micro sprint car, which looks just about like one of those sprint cars, but it's on a very smaller scale. It also has a roll cage. Destruction Derby.
Oh, yeah, I used to like that.
I love the lines on the bottom. Bone chilling, spine jangling, nerve wracking.
But you know what was also really nice about it? You know, we can talk about the homegrown drivers like Hinnerschütz, like Johnny Thompson, Joey Chitwood, and so many of those drivers who came from, who hailed from Reading and Berks County, but it was also the other drivers who came to Reading.
Foyt,
Parnelli Jones, Jim Hurtubise, Eddie Sachs, the Unser brothers, Mario Andretti, you know, and also Johnny Rutherford, who was here and raced the sprint cars and the championship cars out at the fairgrounds. And it was also Johnny Rutherford, Fort Worth, Texas, I believe is a three-time winner of the Indianapolis 500. When he turned commentator for NBC Sports, he made the comment, he said that anybody who was anybody in racing raced at Reading, Pennsylvania at one time or another in their career. And I think that's pretty impressive. I mean, when you look at not only the Reading Fairgrounds, but when you look at the history of Maple Grove and how early they were into drag racing, and they remained on top, and they're one of the top venues today on the drag racing scene with their October Classic. It's quite remarkable the legacy that we've had. And Joshua,
it's sort of amazing. As I was going through the research history, as we talk about the national known drivers like Foyt and Andretti that came and raced here in Reading, we also talk about other names that people might recognize and might or might not recognize. We're talking about drivers that were either had won an Indy 500 the previous year or within 2 or 3 months of racing and Reading,
that's right,
are going to win an Indy 500.
That's
so
a good point. Yeah.
This is,
yeah, they didn't, you know, race in Reading and then go to Indy, win Indy, and say, okay, I don't need to do that anymore. They knew how important Reading, Pennsylvania was to their racing career, and they kept coming back.
It would attract all the drivers. They knew the top-notch drivers were going to be in Reading. Speaking of Maple Grove, I've got some neat photos here on the laptop you can have a look at. Some of you might say, now, what in the heck is this when we say Maple Grove? This is actually a satellite view from early 1940 of the Maple Grove area when it was called Brecknock Speedway.
Yeah.
The one constant as we go through these three or four shots here, this grove of trees right here stays about the same. And also notice the pool down here. The pool is still there. They don't use it. It's mostly filled in today. But as we're going through these photos, keep in mind the pool here and these grove of trees. So this is early 1940. Brecknock Speedway opened up in the mid to late 30s, and it basically had finished, I think it was, from what we can find out, it was killed off by World War II, gas rationing. There are stories of racetracks that would hoard gas, but the government was too happy, so the government forced an end to racing. So this is the oval track of Brecknock Speedway. We think they raced till like early 41, and that was just about it, which is about the same time period as Reading Fairgrounds. Okay, let's have a look at the next shot. This is also the same area. Here's the pool. Here's the grove of trees. And if you look closely, you can see the ghost of the oval track right here.
Mm-hmm.
This is a satellite view from the mid to late 50s, and you can see a drag strip. The Stauffers built a drag strip after they were approached by some local draggers who were looking for a legal place to drag. In one of our fact-finding escapades, Simon, I came across a newspaper article on how the local drag racers were meeting with the police to see if they could establish a legal place to drag race so they wouldn't get in trouble much so anymore and also stay safe. So this is from the mid to late 50s when the drag strip was run east to west. Here's the early 70s when the drag strip is north to south.
So, well, that's the grove of trees.
Yeah, that's the same grove of trees.
Okay.
And here's the
pool.
Same. There's the pool right there. So this is from north to south.
Looks like it got longer.
It definitely did get longer. And also notice, as you'll see in the next shot, forget what the name of this road is. It's a public road. They close it when they have races. But there's like a sand trap on the other side of the road in case they get a car that just needs a little more room to stop. But same grove of trees, same pool. And here's a more modern shot from Google Earth. Thank you, Google Earth. Here's the pool, mostly filled in, well, half filled in by this point. Here's the track again. And here's the sand trap here to really, really encourage cars to stop there.
So that's
and that's the same grove of trees right here. Now we've got a road coming through the middle here.
And so right now, in today's modern drag racing, the top fuel cars and the funny cars, they travel a distance, not a quarter mile, but 1,000 feet. But so what we see right there, would they tell us that was a mile?
Yeah, it was originally a fifth of a mile when it was first built, then they enlarged it to a half mile.
So like I said, they can't, the race is over after 1,000 feet, but they still need, when you're going 340 miles an hour, you still need that extra 3/4 of a mile to slow it down. And then maybe a sand trap.
Are they going that fast?
Yeah, they go from, in 1,000 feet, the top fuel cars will go from zero to about 320, 340 miles. You know, in 3.4 seconds.
We'll cycle back through these quickly just so you can get a quick overview now that you know what I'm looking for. Here's the pool. Here's the grove of trees. Also, you can sort of keep track of this by taking note of intersections here because the intersections don't change for the most part. So there we are with the first direct strip, east to west, north to south, and more modern shot.
This is also a really nice exhibit. It's, I think, even maybe more so than we always try and do, but even more so in that this was really a collaborative effort. I mean, with other area clubs, the Reading Fairgrounds Racing Historical Society was just great to work with. I got reunited with a fellow there, Mike Grimm, who I used to go to Burn Township Elementary School probably 50 years ago. Anyway, they have helped us immensely. The Reading Motorcycle Club has really helped us a lot.
Our friends down at the Eastern Motor Museum of Racing in Dillsburg.
Yeah, Lynn Paxton, he's doing a great job. And so it really was being able to get and work with these people and really put together just a first-rate interpretation of a sport that has such a storied history in Reading. A
couple more shots here, then I'll tell you about the vehicles we were able to cram in there very briefly. Then we'll... this is a shot, we're trying to get this verified. This is a shot of the Reading Fairgrounds looking west. The railroad tracks is right here.
West.
Here is Center Avenue right here. This is down towards, there would be a strip mall here today. But the this we were told this is the last day of racing in 79 at the Reading Fairgrounds. The stands here seem to be pretty populated, but the stand here doesn't really seem to be many people there. So I'm curious.
The last day would be
packed. Yeah, that's what I would have thought, but maybe not. Maybe this is towards the end or towards the beginning. But this was taken by a state police helicopter on the last day of racing in 79.
They would have it dated, I would think, yeah.
We know the date of the last day.
Right. But I mean, I thought that if it's taken by the state police, you would think they'd have
that
this date.
Came from a private collector, it's sort of a copy.
Okay.
Here's a good shot down at Maple Grove. Another gentleman was able to help us out with the exhibit. A very well-known local racer turned engine builder, Carl Ruth. This is an early shot at Maple Grove. We have a nice little video that shows racing at Maple Grove in the early 60s, mid-60s, and also a comparison from the Keystone Nationals in 96. It's amazing to see the way the place grew up over the years. The first few videos, first few years, is not even a concrete block building with a hand starter with a guy with a flag and just the drivers watching. Then, of course, you get into today's scene here.
There's an old timer.
This is neat. This is the concrete building. This is probably the first building they put up here. Right here, as I was told, this is a surplus Army cargo parachute. And the driver here over his right shoulder would have a D-ring so he could pull it to pull the parachute. So we could stop at the other end.
That's well, they weren't going 300 miles an hour.
They can't reach.
Yeah.
Here's a real early color shot. Fire truck standing at the ready. Nice pan shot there. Here we go. Speaking of Tommy Hendershitz, here we go. This is not the car we have. This is the Fromm Offie that he later drove. The car we have is the Miracles Power Special that was built in 54 for him. But here he is getting ready for a race at the Reading Fairgrounds. And here's a classic shot of Tommy as well. This was taken by Carl Ruth when Carl was 10 years old.
Wow.
And Tommy apparently was well known for wearing his one-piece farmer's outfit. They said his most serious accident ever was an accident on the farm. He was a very, very lucky driver when you're considering this is all the days before a roll cage.
For anything, roll bars.
Yeah. So this is the car we have in the exhibit itself on the trailer being checked out before a race. And I think that's the last image.
Well, that first picture that you showed with the racetrack and that oval, was that taken from an airplane or what?
Yes. There's a wonderful website. It's called Penn Pilot. You can, anywhere in Pennsylvania, I seem to be a fan of satellite imagery. I use it for tracking old abandoned roads. But there's a website called Penn Pilot. you can go on there and look through any part of the Commonwealth, and it gives you four or five different time periods to look from, and you can download either a low res, a medium res, or a high res photograph. These are actually from high res photographs that I was able to crop down. Pretty wild. It's amazing satellite imagery.
For how much of Berks County?
Everything. The whole county. Just about the entire Commonwealth is on there. It's a joint project, I think, between UPenn and the Pennsylvania Geological Society, I think. But it's called Penn Pilot. Go to Google and type in Penn Pilot. PennPilot. But it's called Penn Pilot. Here's the vehicles we've been able to cram into the building by hook or by crook or by tongue depressors and whatever methods we can get in
taking
there.
Taking wheels off.
Let's see. Our first vehicle in was a 27 Harley raced by Red Wolverton. Yep. We just got a complimentary bike today. It's a Billy Huber tribute bike. We just talked about Billy Huber. That's a 46 Harley. We've got the 54... It's an Offenhauser, but Hilligus. It's a 54 Hilligus with Offenhauser engine. We've also got a separate Offenhauser engine to show what the Offies look like.
Here we get that 110.
Yep. We've got the Micro Sprint. We've got a mini Grand Prix car that was raced on Reading in the 80s and the 90s right down here on Penn Street, basically right outside the front door of BCTV here. We've got a drag bike that was won a trophy down at Maple Grove in about 2001. And we've also got a flathead engine, which was used up until 62, but started about the 30s and the 40s at the fairgrounds there. And we're also pending, we've got, hopefully, we have a junior stock car coming in, the kind they would have raced down 13th Street by the Gustiatrin, what came to be the Gustiatrin post office out there.
And let's just, I think they're asking for a break, but let's just remind the audience that the exhibit opens this coming Saturday, April 9th. Refreshments for the second Saturday program will begin at 9:30. We will have a racing round table for the opening program, and we're going to have Freddie Adams, Russ Smith,
Carl
Ruth.
Yep.
Who else?
Al Gasparri.
He's great to listen to. Dude, he'll tell you about the
Russ Smith was a 62-point champion. And also, everybody keep your fingers and toes crossed. As long as we have some nice weather, we're going to have some cars on the grass and also the parking lot of cars that we weren't able to either fit in the building or get in the building. So as long as the weather holds out, it's going to be...
Are you going to videotape that roundtable business or whatever?
If we have access to a video camera, we'd love to. Yeah, but we can easily auto record it.
And you could put that on YouTube like we did with the brewery business.
Certainly.
Talk to our good friend.
Remember, kind of refreshments afterwards, fair food, cheesesteaks, and...
Cheesesteak, all
kinds
fries,
of good
hot dogs, hamburgers, popcorn. It's gonna be a fun day.
Yeah,
it really will be a fun day. I guess I got to go to break.
Yes, that's correct.
Uh-huh. You're watching the Historical Society of Berks County on BCTV.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For other information on local heritage societies and local history, go to bctv.org. The Historical Society of Berks County on bctv.org is underwritten by the Highlands. To find out how you and your business can support a program on BCTV, go to bctv.org.
Joshua, can we skip over to a couple of those? Yes,
we're
good
to go.
Okay. Some more pictures that we're getting ready for the passing scene, volume 19. But we have the first one, Joshua.
Yep, it's up. Here we go.
Uh-huh. Now, I don't have a then and now picture of this, but here's the Reading Larry Haynes.
Be too depressing.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Larry Haynes made this available to us, a picture taken at the Reading Brewery. Unfortunately, I think we know two people who were on there, and we're not sure who the rest are. In the book, that'll be in high resolution on the screen. I'm not sure that you can make out too many of the faces, but if anybody recognizes anybody who's on there, we would very much be interested in learning who they are, because we'd like to identify as many as we possibly can. Is there a home viewer? Yes, home viewer, you're on. Whoops.
Call back.
Dalto means goodbye.
Yeah, I guess it does. Okay.
Please go back.
Maybe have the next picture, please.
Oh, on eBay, that thing popped up.
Maybe if you show some train photos.
Yeah, show some train photos. On eBay, this popped up, and it was a $10 bill issued by the First National Bank of Ole. Mr. Bertlett then was president of the bank. And those things were issued about 1929. This fascinated me, and I thought, well, that would be interesting for the next book to have a facsimile of that bill, which I paid a goodly amount of money for. I didn't get it for $10, needless to say. But
I was going to say I would give you $10 for it.
Anyhow, I thought, well, let's check into this Ole Bank business. The next picture, please. That was the Ole Bank.
Mm. Post office too.
It became the post office a little bit later, and then it was used as for hair. A hairdresser was in there, and people driving by wanted to know what did that hairdresser have that required bars on all those windows.
That they had a haircut.
Yeah.
Keep them.
So that was the building years ago. Well, let me just take a little break. Home viewer, are you on? Home viewer?
Hi. I was wondering, when was the picture of the Reading Brewery employees taken?
That's a good question. It's not dated. If I were to guess, it was probably after repeal. Maybe what, 34, 35?
Oh, that long ago.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to remember when they switched to Old Reading. I'm
I do have a 40s, poster 50s. That shows... it has individual pictures and their names of all the people that worked for the brewery.
Oh.
But it was a lot, you know.
It was newer than that.
Yes.
But you know what? That would be interesting. Call the society sometime. Maybe we could match up some faces. Call the Historical Society. Ask for the Archives Library. And maybe Kimberly Richards can get your name and we can set up a time to take a look at that.
Okay.
That would be interesting, because a picture is really interesting if you know the people who are on it.
Mm. Yeah, well, it's a wonderful poster. Somebody gave it to me. It's a copy of a poster that they had in their basement, and they gave it to me for Christmas.
Ah, nice.
Nice, yes.
Okay, thanks for calling.
Okay, thank you.
Take Bye. Care. I believe we have a home viewer. Yes, home viewer. Hello, you're on. Are you still there? We're not. Okay. Next picture, please. Okay. If you go back one, this was taken probably in the 50s, 54, 55. Now, the Ole Post Office had been in that building after the bank built new quarters. Now, I went to the site. And this next picture shows you what it looked like a short time ago. That was taken like 2-3 months ago when we had snow. Notice that they added a portion out the back that wasn't there originally. But that's the building essentially as it looks right now.
Still got some bars on the front.
I know, right?
Oh, yes. Uh-huh. Nothing like a little security. Now, when this building was vacated, they built a new bank down the street. Well, we have the next picture. And that is the new building down the street. And that picture was taken, I think, around 1957. Now, take a good look at the front door. Notice those two very interesting lights on either side of the front door. And on the left-hand, on the right-hand side at one time, folks, there was a church over here on the far right, an evangelical church that Mr. Bertlett had been affiliated with and actually paid the minister's salary. And the story is told that the Mr. Bertlett died on a Wednesday and they didn't have church on Sunday.
Yeah.
Think about that.
Huh.
They tore the evangelical church down and they made way for a large parking lot on the right-hand side. So let's go to that site today. And that's what the property looks like. Picture was taken about 7-8 weeks ago, I guess.
Wow. Oh, yeah, we did.
Basis of comparison.
Yeah.
Interesting. For the next book, what I'm trying to do, and it takes twice as long to do, is to include as many now pictures as I possibly can, because it does give you a frame of reference. Many times people recognize a current scene. If you want just old photographs, regardless of the explanation, having a current view does give a whole new perspective to the illustration. The next picture, please, Joshua. Well, this has been in the newspapers quite a bit, and that's the one-room schoolhouse at Jacksonwald. The bone of contention is this turn coming up the Boyertown Pike on the right-hand side, and you're heading towards Mount Penn. Coming up, if you want to go turn right and go to the Oley Turnpike, it doesn't look like much of an incline, but it is a fair incline when you turn that corner. And they're concerned about building the new schools down the road along the Boyertown Pike, and with school buses coming up there and trying to make a turn, that could cause a problem. So what has been proposed, there were two proposals. Number one was to move the schoolhouse back on that lot so that they could shorten that corner, or to move it down to the new elementary building, the O'Watton building down the road that's now under construction. May have the next view. And that gives you a closer view of that building. Now, Exeter Township is the only township, the only school district that still has a one-room schoolhouse in as part of its property. Simon.
Too late for the March pie dinner. Too late.
Oh, darn.
Too late.
Yes, but I think Spangsville will be having ham and dandelion this Saturday.
All right.
Yes. So we missed the pot pie. Anyhow, then I took from across the street. So what will happen? Chances are that building will be moved down the Boyertown Pike, and it'll be put on the premises of the new elementary school, the Exeter School. There, I guess it's called O'Watton for the creek that runs by. The next. Now, this was made available to me, and I found it very interesting. That was the old Bingaman farm. Now, what do you think about that picture?
It's a good picture.
It's nice and sharp. Yes. Mm-hmm. you know what I'm getting at. Okay. Now, let's have the next picture.
What's
getting at, Kim?
I did lighten the sky just a tad. And let me tell you see, there is a little difference there. Would you believe I spent 2 hours, go back again, see that grape arbor with all those little stems and twigs?
Yeah.
I spent 2 hours cleaning out the grape arbor while my own lawn looked like the devil. But anyhow, that's what I did. And there in the front, you have Samuel Bingaman and his wife. Now, this would be when you take Hill Road, heading towards Lake Antietam. You're coming down the road, Hill Road, heading for Lake Antietam, which would lie directly before you. And this would be on the left-hand side, on the north side of Hill Road, heading down towards Lake Antietam. And I wondered just what was there today. And when I first saw this picture, I didn't make the connection of what this really was.
Mm-hmm.
So the next picture. Oh, that is Mr. Bingaman. That is that gentleman who was standing there with his wife. I'll go back again with that. Okay, now you see the building. Now this, the camera is looking, is pointing northward.
Right.
Now, I could not get that picture today because of trees and bushes and everything else. That was impossible. So I did the next best thing. This is off to the right.
Yeah.
Hill Road would be on the left-hand side. That's what's there today. Old-timers refer to this as the baby factory, but what it actually meant was they had taken children there for health reasons, out back, and because of the air, and you know, those are the days of open of the what did they call it?
Sanatoriums.
Well, yes, Redding had
springs and yeah, resort.
Right,
right.
Redding had one at Northeast. Those open air classes, open air classes, when the teacher would sit there with a fur coat on, and the kids, you know, have pictures of the teacher with the fur coat, and the kids had all the windows were open for the fresh air and all of that sort of thing. Maybe go back to that again.
I'm trying to figure out why all the trellis work. Was he so interested in growing grapes?
Well, there's grapes.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Yeah?
It was a grape arbor.
I mean, I can't believe how quick the trees grow. I mean, when was that taken, George? You think?
That I took, I mean, this picture.
No, the one, the older one. What was that, turn of the
century? Oh, no, that might have been, they moved out of the late 1870s.
Yeah, because you can tell by your dress.
Yeah, 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 sure. Well, still, I mean, it's a lot different today.
Isn't it? So, so what happened, that evolved into, the building stood empty for a while, and then it became like a nature museum. Remember that, the Nature Museum on Hill Road? Mm-hmm. And that is no longer the major, presently, it's unoccupied. But and I knew about that building, but I never didn't associate it with that old picture. The next view. Doesn't that strike you as being rather small for a farmhouse, all things considered? But that's the back of the building, and Hill Road would be on the right hand side. All those other buildings that you saw in that first picture, there's nothing left of that business, whatever. I couldn't find a foundation of any of those other buildings that were there. And surely at one time there was a barn there and other buildings. I could find no vestige, whatever, a week or so ago when I went back there to look for that. And the next picture, please. Okay, that's it. We're going to stop. And I believe it's whose turn?
I'll talk about a couple of things, okay. One in the recent past and one that's in the future. This last Saturday, the 2nd of April, we held our inaugural lecture on the Terrence E. Connor Esquire Forum on the American Presidency. And this was in honor of Terrence E. Connor, who was a past president of the Historical Society of Berks County for 32 years. And Diane Connor, his wife, approached us and said that she wanted to do a program that might have been a little bit out of the norm for the Historical Society. And so we were looking for something that would give a fresh perspective. Well, this really did it, because we can do topics that are different. This particular year, we were focusing on Abraham Lincoln because it's the 150th anniversary of the start of the Civil War. And so we chose Abraham Lincoln, and we looked for a scholar who would add a fresh perspective and a different perspective. And we found that in Matthew Pinsker, who is the chair of the history department down at Dickinson College. And it really was, it was a great experience. It was a collaborative effort with Albright College, and there was a seminar earlier in the day, symposium with Albright students, and then they came to the Historical Society at 4 o'clock in the afternoon for Dr. Pinsker's lecture. And the lecture was called Boss Lincoln, Abraham Lincoln as a Political Party Leader. And it was quite interesting. We had over 140 people in attendance. So it really looks like this is going to be a mainstay yearly event at the Historical Society. But what really struck me with how great this was that on Saturday, last Saturday, we had a very thoughtful and scholarly discussion on Abraham Lincoln as a political party leader. And this coming Saturday, we're going to be talking about Tommy Hinnerschütz, sprint cars, modified stock cars, dragsters, flathead Fords, and the like. So I always ask the question, where do you get diversity like that besides the Historical Society of Berks County? And that's one of the great things of our organization. We do pretty much run the gamut on the topics we discuss. So look for it next year. We were thinking, since we're still into the Civil War, we were thinking that maybe we'd present the other side of the coin and look at not just
Jefferson Davis.
Thank you, John.
You're welcome.
Jefferson Davis, the Confederate States President. So that's tentative, but we'll give you more details as that comes around. The other thing I wanted to talk about is we have made a change at the Historical Society, and that is regarding our members update newsletter. In the past, we always printed a hard copy of the members update newsletter, but in an effort to be more cost effective, to save paper, to put less stress on our landfills, to take a more green approach, we're going to be offering the members update in the same format, at least aesthetically, as it was before, only we're going to do it in an electronic format, and we're going to be offering it in a number of ways. We are going to put it as an embedded link into the news bits so that when it comes out, you'll be able to see it there. We will also send notification to our members on that the current issue of the members update is available, and we'll also put a link on our website to show that the members update is available. So, you know, in the past, if you lost your copy, you'd have to come into the historical site and get a new one. This way, all you have to do is go to our website and you'll be briefed and you'll be up to date on everything that's going on at the historical society with a description of the events that we have. So we hope that you find this as a favorable change and, like I said, one that you'll be very fond of, because it is, like I said, it's a way to just help the environment and use less paper. So did I miss anything on that one?
I think so.
I think that's about it. I think that about covers it.
You know, a quick comment about Abraham Lincoln, how appropriate it was to have Abraham Lincoln as the first subject for three major reasons. Number one, his paternal ancestors came from Berks County. Number two, when he put out the call for men, the first defenders came from Reading and Berks, answered his call, went to Gettysburg. And the third thing, really close to the Historical Society, is the gravesite of Matilda Edwards. Matilda Edwards Strong, who sort of captured his fancy at one point in his life.
You know, when we were talking, I was sorry that Michelle Lynch couldn't attend this lecture this time. She had other obligations, but because when we brought the subject up to Dr. Pinsker, he immediately knew who we were talking about, and I really wish Michelle would have been there to discuss it with him, because I think he would have found it fascinating. She's done a lot of research on that. But with that said, Michelle's going to be at the Historical Society, I believe, for the second Saturday in May to do the Matilda Edwards, talk on Matilda Edwards, I don't know, what do you want to call that? Friend of Abraham Lincoln. So
yes,
friend.
Yeah, make those big quotes.
There's a great picture in passing scene 17, where she's putting flowers on Matilda Edwards Strong's gravesite. A really very nice picture.
There's a couple of quick events we got to get to here before we can get him in, before we get lynched. Let's see here. It's coming up this Saturday, April 9th, the same day as our racing opening. We have our annual monthly Hendel House opening from 11 to 4. It's an open house. It's our darling of a Victorian mansion located right in Center Park at 746 Center Avenue, 11 to 4. It's a beautifully decorated, beautifully done house. The woodwork is amazing. Find me something who can replicate that woodwork, and I'll give you a substantial amount of money.
Open what, every Wednesday this month for the egg tree.
Yep, also egg tree.
Yeah. Egg tree's up.
And they're also very getting ready for their tea party. They've already had one or two already, right, Kim?
I don't know. I think this Saturday is their first tea.
First one. Right. And also coming up, we have the Felicity and Samantha's Tea Party. We are very happy to welcome back Rainbow Theater. It's a child's acting group. They have their upcoming performances April 15th, which is a Friday evening at 7 p.m., and also the 16th at 3 and 7, which is a Saturday, and also Sunday at 3 o'clock as well. Children from the Rainbow Theater will perform two darling plays, one about Felicity and the other about Samantha, two endearing girls of America. And after the play, we'll have light refreshments as well as a meet and greet with the cast and the crew. And that will be held at our main building at 940 Center Avenue. Adults are $12 and children are $10. Please call to reserve your seat and ask for Vicki Hefner. And tickets also include admission to the Historical Society, our two special exhibits, Keeping Cozy and also Uncoverlets, and also Racing and Running in Berks County.
Don't forget that Easter egg tree. That's a winner.
Because it's the same tree that they used last year.
But it's all different eggs.
Right, it's different eggs.
We can go, I don't know how many years, doing different Easter eggs out of our collection. It really is quite amazing.
Vicki was able to come up with a plan, and along with her willing and able assistant, walking it from the front door around the corner and the carriage house. I'm
just
sorry.
Just as interesting as I'm trying to get the Hinnerschitz car into the...
We cover all bases.
Yeah. Very, very delicate and brittle tree, but we made it in with only a couple minor breaks. But
and speaking of covering all the bases, was there something that you wanted to bring to our attention?
Yes.
I don't think we're going to get to the deeds. If anything, we've discovered recently that we spend actually more time processing older collections than we do newer collections. So for the sake of time, I'm just going to introduce that the Henry Janssen Library now has an Adopt-a-Collection program. And what we're trying to do is we're trying to get donors who are willing to help sponsor supplies so that we can process collections. For example, what I did bring today were three deeds. All the oldest known deed that we have is 1717 for the Ole area.
Which is really, really early.
Real quick, it's this one right here.
These need to be preserved.
These are, we're trying in the process of preserving them. They actually, at one point, had put them in Mylar, which you shouldn't put Mylar, parchment in Mylar, because parchment needs to breathe. It's animal skin. But we've got at least 2,000 deeds, and we don't have enough room to store them. It's kind of standard, you know, at the Henry Janssen Library, running out of room. So we're kind of hoping that we can get some generous donors to help us with supplies, because archival supplies do tend to get kind of expensive. And what we want to do is we want to make sure that these deeds, like all the other collections that we have, stick around.
A lot of those archival supplies can last more than a lifetime.
Yeah, really. Yeah. This one I did bring. This is one of the pen deeds for the, it's lot number...
Show it to him.
Well, I am. yes, I think it's 222.
Show that tag.
It still has part of the original seal. So it's around Clement Street.
Oh, there we go.
And, you know, like, we've learned a lot about the deeds over the past month, including about the Quaker calendar, the Gregorian calendar. The other deed I brought has a patent date of February 30th, 1752. It's a real date, we learned. So if you're interested, please contact us and help us preserve history for future generations.
Did you have a suggested amount of, like, categories?
We do. There's specific categories. Not really. We're running out of time. We do have kind of like a breakout of, for like $50, your money will go to buy one box, believe it or not, of archival folders, which is 100 count, a couple boxes. Larger donations will take care of entire collections.
So $50 will get you started.
That's right.
$50 will get us started.
We're recognizing the folks who make the contributions to these adopted collections.
Well, tell your friends about our show, which is on live the first Wednesday of each month at 7. The program repeats this Friday night at 10, Saturday at 6, and Sunday morning at 8 a.m. Thanks to today's panel, Kimberly Richards, Joshua Blay, Syme Bertlett. I'm George Miser, your host and a 51-year member of the Historical Society of Berks County. We look forward to having you join us again on the first Wednesday at 7 o'clock in May. Thanks for watching.